one, two, three, four, linear profiles. I've talked about them in the past, right?
It's just a different way to work. In all of my tests, which I spent the bulk of 3 or 4 days working through several raw files, trying to see if I would gain a lot of benefit from a linear profile, in all of my tests, I didn't see anything earth-shattering that said, Blake, you've got to do these linear profiles. They're going to make your workflow so much better. But workflow is actually a pretty personal thing, whether you want to think about it as a personal thing or not. The things that I do in my images and how I operate with my images are very personal to the way I like to work. Am I going to use linear profiles? I probably will use them, but not necessarily on every single image. As I said, there are going to be images that I'll probably gain some benefit from using a linear profile, but I don't think it's going to change my workflow forever. I feel like linear profiles these days are kind of a buzzword. It's kind of like luminosity masking. When it first came out, everybody wanted to know what it was and how to use it. Linear profiles are very much the same for me in that regard.
I told you the same thing about 2 months before this guy. And as he says, buzzwords. Let's try this, let's try that. Because our circulatory system is not screwed enough. Let's sit more in front of the computer. You have already paid Nikon for the profiles. These are your settings for the best straight out of camera, the best chances to get straight out of camera in the proper light, so that you can take the files directly to the lab for printing. And if you're not printing, most likely standard profile with no other settings is just fine. The D850's neutral profile, by the way, is a sort of a linear profile tweaked for the D850 sensor. If you are working with Lightroom or Adobe Camera Raw, do not use with the D850 the Adobe Color, Adobe Standard Portrait. Do not use these. Use the camera matching profiles. Camera matching, let's say standard, is a good profile. Do not use, again, I repeat, the Adobe Color and all that other stuff. They're terrible. And do not forget to click this thing, the line under the image, and a menu like that will appear that says Workflow. For editing, be in the Profoto RGB, preferably 16 bits, and where it says RAW Defaults, choose camera settings, in which case you can also save multiple cameras here. Shooting the landscape at 70 miles an hour, says Petapixel. My daughter has mastered this, and I told her, keep one point in your viewfinder, a specific point, on a specific point of the building as I drive by. And this is the result. This one is sharp, well, as much as it could be at 70 miles an hour. The rest is running. To show that the rest is running, you have to kind of lower the shutter speed to show the effect of the motion. This is the D500 with a kit zoom lens, 200th of a second f5. This is of course better because I was going slower and she used a much higher shutter speed. D500, kit zoom lens, 2000th of a second f5. It's one of our traditions. I drive and she takes pictures.
In the mid-60s, American cities were very troubled. There was poverty, there was crime, there were race riots, there was a lot of worry about whether or not they could even survive. New York was troubled. There was a lot of worry about New York's future.
Should be demolished and replaced with a high-technology landmark building.
2 and 3 years ago, I made these two videos with title Be the Historian of Your Town, because American cities tend to change very quickly. And if you take a few pictures of, let's say, stores and roads and even mini malls, whatever, that you consider boring today, 10, 15 years from now, they're gonna start being historic. because of the way American cities change all the time. People say, oh, look at these old photos of my town, let's say New York. I wish I had taken them. Well, if you're not taking them today, you wouldn't have taken them back then either. So you want to have old pictures of New York 20, 30 years from now? Take them now. Don't just rely on those that the tourists are going to take with their iPhones.
Pretty closely matches what I see when I'm just looking at the world. So maybe normal was defined from the perspective of the photographer, what made the viewfinder look natural when the viewfinder was approximately the size of the film.
So why do we call a 50 millimeter a normal lens? It's not because from side to side it covers what the vision, human vision sees. No, no, no. The human vision has huge peripheral vision. It's almost like a fisheye lens. We call it a normal lens because the distances from close to far and then further away match the impression that we have of the distances in real life. Because people confuse normal with the field of view, the human field of view, which is not correct. The human field of view is huge. You stand up in front, your peripheral vision is pretty much fisheye. However, when we say normal human view, we mean the distances from close to far. So here, for example, when he says down here at the bottom, normal view seen by the human eye, it doesn't mean that the human eye catches only this, this is 50 millimeter here, only this narrow 45 degree angle field of view. In reality, the field of view closer to the human eye would be even lower than 14 millimeters here. It would be like 10, 12 millimeters, very wide. What he means by normal lens at 50 millimeters, he means that the distances between the close objects and the far objects are more realistic, so that the distances from close to far look realistic. Proportions, without being wide angle, just gigantic in the side. You're not going to, in the back, capture with this lens and this sensor size, one half, but if you want to maintain normal proportions, like normal vision, and still have this human field of view, what kind of sensor should you use? Well, I made some rough the sensor. Take it from real life. You stand across the street. What are you paying attention to? What is your field of attention? This view. Now, if you want to see traffic lights, for example, although your peripheral vision is catching them, but what do, right? We turn our head to the right, we turn our head to the left to see anything else. We don't just sit there with our head straight forward trying our peripheral vision, right? We turn our head. But if you don't turn your head, this is your immediate view of attention. This is what you observe. Now, let's get it to 30 millimeters. At 30 millimeters, you see this part of the road here that's right in front of you. In order to see this under normal conditions, what do? You tilt your head down. Now, your peripheral vision, as you're looking straight forward, is also capturing the cars that are coming from left to right, if they're moving. If they're not moving, although your peripheral vision is capturing them, you ignore them. Because your immediate field of attention is this. This is what you pay attention to. Now, this video that you just saw is, of course, simplified, is practice-oriented. The purpose of the next one, though, after we understood what a normal lens is, will be minimalism. How to end up with the least lenses possible to do everything you want to do. Tony has to make videos like that because he has to increase traffic to his site so that he gets more money from Squarespace and the affiliated links. But my videos gotta have a purpose, so use the search field. Look at this, yesterday's article on F-stoppers about exposure. High engagement, 15 comments. So you click on it, there must be something magic going on inside it. It's page 5 of every manual of every camera in the last 30 years. So why would they put such an elementary article? For traffic. I mean, look at the other ones. This one is about technique, 0. People don't care about technique, they know everything. 12, because Canon issued yet another camera, 0, 0, 0. 25, because people are not interested in technique and art, they just want to buy more gear. Petapixel, wedding photographer scammed couple with blurry images. Do you see what's missing from these images? Lights. No flash, nothing. If I wanted to book a photographer, I would ask him what strobes and what speed lights he's gonna bring. And if he doesn't have any, no contract. Instead, we're gonna use something like this. It's got a little flash from what I see, so the pictures will be better. Zeitwill, from the previous video. There is a big but, and that is you have to find the perfect subject for this angle. That's why I say in this video part 1. There is a part 2 coming. L. Rondon is asking, what do you think about high PPI screens on smartphones? Some of them are already very high PPI. The iPhone 14 is about 416. Now here is a very high resolution image supposedly displayed on a small screen, like an iPhone screen. Can you see the B? No, you can't. Why? It's there. It's right there. But you cannot see it because the screen is too small. So you're forced to magnify to see the B, right? Not even this size is enough. You have to magnify to see the B. It was there all along, but the screen was too small. And this is a very high resolution image on an iPhone screen. And what's in the image? A bunch of trees. Can you see details on the trees? No. They're there. They're displayed. But you cannot see them. Why? Because the screen is too small. So you're going to be forced to magnify. Well, if you're going to magnify anyway, why would you need the high resolution screen? There are basically two scenarios of use. The first is movies. Movies we regularly watch, though, are very low PPI. So we watch The Godfather and we enjoy it, but if we pause it, it looks like a 2-megapixel image. Do that with any movie, you'll be surprised. And the second scenario is photographs. But the screen is tiny for that, for details. Even if they are displayed, our human eye cannot catch them. You have to pinch and magnify. And if you resort to pinching and magnifying, you didn't need the high-resolution screen to begin with. Professional editors recommend 100 and 130 PPI for editing so that you can see the areas that are perfectly in focus versus areas that are almost in focus, and 120 to 200 for viewing pleasure, high-resolution viewing pleasure, but the monitor has to be respectively large because I have a 24-inch 4K Dell monitor, which is so dense that even the bokeh looks sharp. And that is why we have a 47-inch television, which is 4K, 8.3 megapixels, which means 94 PPI, and it looks fantastic. So what I think is that over 200 PPI on smartphones is a waste. I would say even over 150. You need to magnify to see the details anyway, because the screen is small, and causes faster battery consumption, because you have to populate and refresh all those pixels all the time. Alexa, How do I transfer money that I have in my mind to my bank account?
You cannot transfer money from your mind to your bank account. Get a job.
This AI thing is useless. Anyway, this viewer says your photos are very three-dimensional. Isn't this the main indicator of photo quality? No, not at all. Dimensionality is not even in the list of quality characteristics of a photograph. Quality depends on the use, the desired quality. Some people want a very sharp image. Some people want an image without any distortion, and so forth and so on. As far as the usefulness of the picture, number one is the subject. If somebody asks you for a picture of a salad, you're not going to send them a very three-dimensional picture of a donkey. And as far as general photography is concerned, it better be interesting, because if it's not interesting, nobody's going to care about technical quality. And if you're just a hobbyist shooting for yourself, what photographs are useful to you and what photographs are interesting to you? That's what matters. Lloyd Chambers has an article in his blog. Sony 16-shot pixel shift works in the field. Transis, the Fujifilm GFX, might match the Phase 1. How does that work in reality? Because people say, oh, the sensor moves by one pixel. That's mechanically impossible. What happens is that in the first shot, the camera starts recording from the first pixel line all the way down. And in the second shot, let's say, it may start recording from the second or the third or the fourth pixel line all the way down. It will be impossible to mechanically move the sensor by one pixel. So basically, you change where it starts recording on the sensor. It is not entirely problem-free. He spotted Pac-Man bites on the edges of objects in the 16 image samples, and you can see them here. I don't know if you can see them, little lines that appear over the horizontal lines and the vertical ones. And he says over here, he cannot explain it. And he says, how could any movement make a notch exactly every other pixel? Which basically means that it starts recording on the third pixel line. But I'm not telling him that. Because if I tell him, he's going to say, no, no, there must be something else. And then 5 months later, he's going to say the same things that I've been saying. Like 4 years ago, when I made this video, and discovered with detailed pictures that I have here, that the iPhone was making up things in the image that did not exist. And everybody was disagreeing with me, including him, and now he sees it himself. He sees it himself that the iPhone changes things. It alters details. Of course, my channel is a low production channel. If I wanted to make it a high production channel, I would have people with white robes, actors, and I would name it Lab something, Photo Lab or something like that. And did you know that the resolution tests that you see in websites are based on results from IMATEST, which is based on JPEGs? It measures pixels and everything from JPEGs. And that's the most reliable ones. At any rate, though, you better not have anything moving within those 4 images or 16 images. And at the end, you're going to get a gigantic file. That's what you're getting. You're getting a lot of pixels that you're never going to see on your monitor. You're only going to see small parts of it as you zoom in and you scroll up and down, left and right. Because even if your monitor is 4K, it can only display 8 megapixels at a time. In the old days, we used to tap the camera on the tripod just a little bit so that it visibly it does not show that it has changed place. So it looks still. But this little tapping, although with a human eye it looks like it's in the same exact place, it actually moved quite a few pixels. And then you take a second and third shot, and you can bracket them too. If you want maximum dynamic range, what have you. And of course, then you combine them in Photoshop and this and that, but it's not gonna make your images more interesting. And of course, if you upload them on the internet, they get compressed to 8-bit color depth JPEGs with sRGB color space. And then which viewer has this or that monitor and what browser are they using? If there is one thing that I agree fully with Lloyd Chambers and many other photographers, is that Firefox is the best browser right now, is the most color aware for images. On BenQ's website, they have this page over here, color management for your web browsers. And they have instructions, and they have these browsers over here. And on Firefox, they say that needs to be activated. And it's got instructions on how to do it over here. It seems that I do not need it. And even if I did it, I will have to change it every time I calibrate the monitor, because it will create a new ICM file. So I just leave it in the default settings. Over here in this table, they also imply in this table that Microsoft Edge is probably the better one for color, because it takes the ICM profile directly from Windows, which is the one that you're already using. My problem with Microsoft Edge is that it is not very user-friendly for things that I need for my work, so I haven't been using it. You can give it a try though by opening up a JPEG that you already know inside the browser and test two or three different browsers and just compare them. William Kazak talks about lens flare. When I had the Voigtlander 58, I also had bought the original Voigtlander lens hood, but I didn't want to damage it, so I bought a different lens hood from B&H, which was just a little longer, like a quarter of an inch longer. And I noticed that the images were a little better. A little better contrast, a little better clarity. So I did a comparison test from my back window, and I confirmed it. The lens hood that was a little longer, third party, which was like $9 or something, was actually helping in producing better images. And that was not against the sun. The sun was way in the back. But somehow it was cutting off many other reflections from surrounding buildings that were affecting the lens when I was using the original lens hood. Manufacturers do not want to make the lens hood very long, even if it's not veneering, because then the whole lens becomes quite big. But try something like that. Madman TNT, dark frames are better taken in the place where you take the astro images, as the sensor is sensitive to temperature, humidity, and magnetic interference. Magnetic interference, almost nothing, unless you're talking strong magnets. Humidity, no. Temperature, yes, in the sense that higher temperatures on the sensor produce more noise in the recording in the electronics. But what is a dark frame? A dark frame is the one where all the pixels have zero value on all photo sites. Completely black. Zero, 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 zero. How do you make a file like that? Cap the lens in your room and take a picture at 200th of a second. And all your pixels should be zero, 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 zero. That's your reference file. All the pixels are black. You do not need to retake this image. You keep this file as your reference dark frame.